the evidence of things not seen. Okay? It applies to a number of characters. And sometimes, even for us, our understanding to be, if we look at characters like David or Moses or whatever, things become real for us. We can visualize what it was like for them. And that speaks to us sometimes more than words. Faith is a better way. Faith is instrumental down through the ages, down through the dispensations. So through all the dispensations, people had to have faith. Abraham had faith. Okay? Moses had faith. And all the way down today, we need faith. Faith is a foundation supporting everything else. Okay? So we need faith in our life. Hope is based in the Word of God, that which is written. Salvation, saving faith is active. So the first kind of faith that you experienced when you first reached out to God, it's like sometimes we'll call that saving faith. Okay, so your heart was in a place where you either had someone speak to you, or you came and you read or heard something that caused your heart to be moved and to come to God. And that was the same faith that brought you to there. But you've got faith beyond that carries you forward. So you're no longer being saved, you are saved. Okay? You're no longer going through the process of the new birth. You've been born again of the water and of the Spirit. But you need to live in that, and that takes faith. God has these happen in our daily lives. Through that, trials, anything we face in life are more bearable when we know that Jesus is in there with us. We have eternal rewards which can be seen through the eye of faith. Okay? So we don't know, right? We haven't been on a package tour to heaven yet. Okay? We haven't been taken there to see what it's like. We can read what it's like. But through faith we can believe and say, well, one day we're going to be there. You know, and one day this old body, physical, will be shaken off and we'll have glorified bodies that have no more pain, no more discomfort, no more sickness, no more, you know, depression and all of these things. You know, because we can see through the eye of faith that things will be better. Faith is indeed the foundation doctrine of the Bible. Abraham heard and believed God. Cain, Abel's brother, neglected the instruction of God. And we know what happened to him because he ended up killing his brother. Enoch pleased God. Noah obeyed God. Even when he had to build a great big boat in the middle of a field, no water around. And people mocking him, all the rest of it, he obeyed God. Abraham had unquestioning obedience to God when he raised up that knife to slay Isaac, you know, because God had told him to go and sacrifice his son. He had unquestioning obedience to God. And through that, he lived by faith. Isaac and Jacob surrendered their wills to divine intervention. So they surrendered themselves to God. By faith, Moses turned away from the courts of Egypt and renounced that, and went out and took the children of Israel out from Egypt and out towards the promised land. Moses discovered that God's worst is indeed better than Satan's best. Can you think about it? Satan trying to give us something that trying to get us interested and think it's nice and all that. But even the very worst that God can give us is better than any of that. Moses looked to the future in faith. Faith was a principle of Moses' spiritual life. The Israelites crossed the Red Sea by faith. Jericho walls came crumbling down because of faith. Albeit that these people had much faith, they didn't receive the ultimate promise. So yeah, the walls of Jericho came down, the walls of some other cities came down, victory was gained, but complete victory wasn't gained because they didn't fully go into that. They should have been more stubborn, but because of that, you know, some groups were still allowed to coexist with them, and that caused them trouble later. But they had faith in the promise. They had faith that they would get through. We now realise that promise through Jesus Christ, our Lord. And we have an encouragement for persevering faith. Okay. So we're in a race to be completed. This is a very kind of famous part of scripture, you know, beginning of chapter 12 of Hebrews. We're in a race to be completed. It doesn't matter who gets there first. The first will be last, and the last will be first. But the point is to complete the race. Our daily activities must be governed by some criteria, okay? So this is some things we need to kind of filter our daily activities through, okay? So when we consider, oh, will I do this or should I do that, okay? So consider this. What will it profit me as a Christian, okay? So what benefit is it to the kingdom of God, whatever that I'm about to do, okay? So find, if you're cooking the dinner or something like that, that's not per se going to benefit the kingdom of God, but it'll give you nourishment, it'll give your family nourishment, and then help them to be built up to be part of the kingdom of God. So there are things that you're kind of going, well, does that really apply? Right? But we should submit the big things and the little things to God. Next point, will it hinder or help my progress? So if you're deciding to take a certain path in life, will that hinder you as a Christian or will it help you? Okay. Some of these questions being asked early on in a decision might help you to make the right decision. We need to keep our eyes fixed on Jesus. We're not to despise the chastening of the Lord. And then we've got exhortations again. We are to show endurance in the following ways. We carry out duties. So we carry out works per se to God, not because of we're trying to do that to attain salvation, but because of salvation and his love for us, that we do so many things to reach out and do as well. So we carry out duties to ourselves, to our fellow believers, so that's ministry. And we carry out duties to God. So we carry out, we pray, we seek God, and we worship him, and we do all of these things. There's motivation for persevering faith. And the main one is that it helps us to avoid apostasy. So if we persevere in faith, then we won't back off from God. Okay? Our hearts won't harden towards God because we're persevering. We're rowing in the right direction. Okay? If the former Hebrews that did not know God per se did not go unpunished for their sins, how should we go unpunished here? So we wait, there is a judgment coming along, but we need to be in the right place. He who shook the heavens and the earth will do so again. The great God is still a consuming fire against evil. And then the conclusion today is in chapter 13. We've got practical principles in the Christian life. Let brotherly love continue is in there. That's a famous scripture as well. And a lot of people take that and kind of twist it a bit and say, ah, so you're a Christian, you're supposed to let brotherly love continue. No matter how insolent or rude or whatever I am to you, you've got to love me because you're a Christian. that's just taking scripture and twisting it. Okay? Mm-hmm. But let brotherly love continue in the purest sense of the word. It must have active expression. We're to show hospitality to strangers. Because the Bible tells us we might be entertaining an angel unawares. We're to have compassion upon those bound in sin. Again, the other night I was saying that the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but are mighty through God to build their strongholds. You know, when people are caught up in sin, it's a very sad situation. But we need to have compassion on them. Not that we condone the sin that they're involved in, but we are compassionate towards the soul. God will judge in due course. We have to be aware of covetousness and be content with what we've got. Okay, so there's in this final chapter, there's quite a few nuggets that are given out just to help us along the way. We are to remember those that have rule over us, okay? Whether they be like spiritual leaders or whether they be, you know, governmental people and things like that. Got to have the same personal respect for them. We might not agree with all that they do, but they are people as well. We're not to be carried around with diverse doctrines. The surest way to end up in a state of apostasy is to start mixing your doctrines and teachings and start getting confused about who God really is, and you start to lose faith. So don't mix doctrines. Let us continually offer the sacrifice of praise. We are not to pollute our sacrifice. And then at the end of chapter 13, it says we must also follow Jesus without the camp. So we're not just outside the church, right? Inside the church, we need to follow Jesus to enjoy the benefit because of his death. So we have many benefits because Jesus died for us. Okay, so this was final sort of thing that was said to the Jewish people. To cleave to Judaism was to reject Christ. So many people who are still Jews don't believe in Jesus. They're still looking for a Messiah, but they don't believe that Jesus ever was. Okay, so these people don't know Jesus. It holds true not just for Jews, but for any religious system that's inconsistent with the gospel. To return to Judaism, or to return to the world, or any other belief system, is to forsake Jesus. We must forsake all, even at the cost of the reproach of this world. So we might get mocked, we might get spat upon, we might get attacked in different ways, but we need to bear through that because we're holding up the banner of love. Everything that's inconsistent with truth and purity must be laid aside if we're to walk with Jesus. Good works are part of Christian life and not to neglect them. And then finally, it's like just personal remarks and greetings and final benediction. And that brings us to the end, a whistle stop for the book of Hebrews. There's a lot more in there than we could ever cover in a couple of hours. Okay? But go read it. Take some instruction from your textbooks that you've got. And, you know, in January when we have the class test, you'll be asked a few fairly straightforward questions. There'll be a few bits and pieces in there where you fill the blanks out like you do with your self-help. So try and do these things. Keep at it. Next month, I think it's about 5 weeks away now, we will go to a new book and we'll have a look at the book of James. So hope you're been blessed by that. Any questions from anybody? Hebrews isn't a kind of a sermon, so, you know, 13 chapters of a sermon. Whoever the author was, you know, some people say it was Paul, some people say it was other people. Somebody had a 13 chapter sermon, more or less. That's how it kind of reads. Okay, when you get to some of the other letters, they're written more like letters. You know, and as a spoiler alert for the book of James, you find that when you read James, there's a whole lot of nuggets in there as well. It kind of reads a bit like Proverbs in the Old Testament. So in Proverbs, you'll get one or two verses that gives you a complete thought. Okay? In James, you'll find that happening as well. So we'll see you in November.
Okay.
God bless you.
God bless you too.